Look, Captain Jack actually ordered me to narrate this video, but I'm still trying to convince myself that being called a Cardassian in the comments is a good thing. But being accused of being one of DS9's signature sneaky species actually seems a bit relevant, because guess what? We're talking about Section 31, another DS9 staple that I was very, very happy to see. With the Section 31 series itself still only a blip on our viewer, and this year being the 20th anniversary of Enterprise... Sorry, I was expecting Where My Heart Will Take Me to suddenly start playing out of nowhere for a moment there. What better time is there to take a look at one of our favorite Starfleet engineers and his involvement with the shady organization that has plagued many elements of Starfleet over time? Hello everyone, I am your host, Ensign Adam, and welcome once again to Trek Central. Today we're diving back into the world of Star Trek Enterprise. I swear I can still hear the theme song, but it's to talk about Charles Tucker III, aka Commander Trip Tucker, the chief engineer of the NX-01 Enterprise and one of Captain Jonathan Archer's best friends. While some of us are still emotional over Trip's fate in Enterprise, there are still plenty of stories to be told. If you want to keep up to date on all the latest Star Trek news, lore, and more, then make sure you hit that subscribe button to never miss a video from the team here at Trek Central. You can also follow us on social media for daily updates on the Star Trek universe. All right, let's hit it. Now, for those of you who wish to remember the series finale, canonically, Trip died in 2161 when the Enterprise and crew made a detour to aid their on-off Andorian ally, Shran, in the rescue of his captured daughter. I'm still in denial of this fact. The ship was boarded during the rescue effort, and Trip valiantly risked his life to thwart a boarding party by overloading and blowing out a plasma junction. He initially survived, but was critically wounded, and was last seen in sickbay going into the imaging chamber, and died a short time after due to his injuries. Sure, the ship and the crew have died and blown up more times than is necessary through their years amongst the stars, but this one was permanent. Or was it? Please, be aware that we are now entering Memory Beta territory, where we'll encounter anomalies which will be in conflict with established canon. They may not make sense at first, but bear with us, and hopefully it'll come together in the end. For reasons that would remain classified for almost 250 years, Trip Tucker was required to fake his death in 2155, a few days short of the formation of the Coalition of Planets, the precursor to the United Federation of Planets that we're all more familiar with. The date of his death was changed from 2155 to 2161, but the reason behind this change is a mystery. But we'll circle back to that later and theorize on that. By the 25th century, files surrounding his faked death were declassified. Tucker had in fact been recruited by a member of the rogue agency we know as Section 31 to infiltrate and sabotage the Romulan Star Empire's efforts in developing a Warp 7 drive, something which would put Starfleet and the Coalition of Planets at a massive disadvantage. In order to do this, he underwent reconstructive surgery on a Digion Prime to appear as Romulan and to be able to infiltrate behind the Romulan Star Empire's lines. The Adigians were familiar with the Romulans, thus able to make the appropriate changes to his appearance. Tucker and Section 31 agent Tin Hok Fong, another name to add to the list of things I've horribly pronounced during my time here, were the first humans to see the true appearance of the Romulan people and realize their relationship with the Vulcans. Section 31 kept the information secret for fear that the fragile Coalition of Planets would shatter should the link between the two cousin species be discovered by other members of the growing alliance. While on the mission, Tucker also gathered intelligence on the Romulans, before the war eventually broke out with the Star Empire in 2156, a war which would challenge everyone. More information on that in a video later on. Tucker retreated from Romulan space in an escape pod after he got into a fight on board the ship he was on. He was soon picked up near the Tezel Oroko star system by the Vulcan cargo freighter Kiraikintha, captained by Tevran. Also on board was Icha, an agent of Visha, the Vulcan Security Directorate, or Vulcan Intelligence Bureau, or one of any other names that might have been easier to pronounce than Vishar and Tivran and Icha and Kirikintha, which I will now forevermore know as the Wellerman. Anyway, Icha, insisted that Tivran allow her to use Trip to assist her in gathering intelligence as to whether Romulans had infiltrated the Vulcan government. So Trip went on to assume the identity of her longtime acquaintance, Sodok. You know, in the usual way that hinges on nobody knowing the actual person. He witnessed Icha perform a mind meld on a Romulan centurion, Terex, to make him believe he was Vulcan. Terex had been previously left without memory of who he was after escaping from an exploding base on Rator 3. Under the guise of Sodok, along with Icha and Terex, they were able to destroy the shipyard at a place that I'm not even going to attempt to pronounce. Oh, alright, fine. Ek Elier. That'll work. A facility where the Warp 7 drive was being built. The destruction of this shipyard critically damaged the Romulan Star Empire's research infrastructure into the Warp 7 drive. With their mission complete, the clandestine agents traveled to Vulcan. The three got involved with T'Pol's investigation into the corruption of T'Pol's government. Following that trip, planned on returning to Enterprise with T'Pol, but ultimately chose to remain with Terex, and ensure he didn't return to his true Romulan self, which was maintained by regular mind melds with Icha. By this point, T'Pol and Malcolm Reed had already attempted the rescue of Tucker from the aforementioned base on Rator 3, so they're clearly in on his position and were well aware that he was in fact alive and did not die on Enterprise years ago. And even if they didn't, escaping from something exploding in your face is a requirement for recruitment into Section 31 and probably would have given the game away anyway. In 2157, following a bombing on Mount Silea, the Vulcan security minister, Psylocke, ordered the arrest of Trip's Vulcan associates, though tasked him with tracking Terex, who had left shortly after the bombing. After 9 months of searching, his ship, Kilhaen, I'm doing that one wrong as well, I'm sure of it, was attacked by the Romulan Admiral Valdor's forces and captured Trip. Admiral Valdor was previously seen in Star Trek Enterprise, as he was a high-ranking Romulan military officer who was already trying to destabilize the coalition of planets by using experimental drone technology. Valdor had the ship repaired and sent his Tal Shiar contact, Colonel Sanders, back out with Tucker to find Ejoy Ormin, a political group operating within and had plans to overthrow the Romulan Star Empire. They also had a facility in the Kareya system, building Warp 7 capable ships. The plan, of course, was thwarted by Trip and Sanders, again setting back the Romulans. During the journey, their ship was damaged in a Hakonan attack, leaving them without communications or warp drive. They managed to achieve near light speed to reach their destination, but due to time dilation, only 2 weeks appeared to have passed for them. When to the outside, it was 2 years. Like Captain Jonathan Archer, Trip 2 played a vital role in the Battle of Chiron, which took place in 2160, which fits in with the 2 years Trip spent traveling at near light speed. The Battle of Chiron being one of the most deadly battles of the Earth-Romulan War. Before the battle, again he was picked up by Admiral Valdor for execution. T'Luad took it upon herself to carry out that order, but instead revealed herself as an undercover Vulcan restaurateur, agent. Sorry, it's the Sanders thing. Tucker was able to send a message to Archer informing him of the Romulan staging area and the 83 Leonis B star system for the invasion of Earth and the other members of the Coalition of Planets. Instead of execution, T'Luad put him in an escape pod. Before launch, she gave him a beacon to be found and rescued. After his years of espionage and mortal danger, understandably, he had developed severe paranoia and believed the beacon to be a bomb. When he was beamed out, it felt to him as though the bomb exploded. It was at this time he realized he could never return to his old life. Following the end of the Earth-Romulan War, Trip had his physical alterations reversed and aided Section 31 again by infiltrating a Terra Prime cell, preventing them from carrying out terrorist activities. Captain Jonathan Archer, who at this point was aware of Trip's involvement in covert missions, had become very uncomfortable with his involvement with the shady agency and more than once before tried to convince his longtime friend to leave. and let his family know he was still alive. Trip felt that he had changed so much in the wrong direction, he did not wish for his family to see what he had become. Whilst he continued for many more years involved with Section 31, he finally decided that he had reached his limit. During the Where crisis, under the alias Philip Collier, he learnt that Section 31 had provided the Klingons a shutdown code, orchestrating the destruction of the Partnership of Civilizations. Tucker had gotten involved in the Wear crisis, with the knowledge that their medical technology could repair the damage to his friend and former Enterprise crew member Malcolm Reed's reproductive system, caused by prolonged use of transporters. And before I go any further, I just want to reinforce that the idea of having your reproductive system destroyed by prolonged use of transporters is not funny. It's not. It's not funny. It really isn't. It's not funny. Okay, maybe it is a bit funny. But either way, Reed refused to take advantage of the system for his own benefit that had cost the lives of so many species throughout the Quadrant, something which set Trip back. Tucker tracked down the immortal being in the Alpha Centauri system, now living under the name Antonius Tyrannalus, after the death of his alias, Wylam Abramson. With centuries of faking his own death, Trip sought his assistance in faking his death, to escape the agency once and for all, and with a determination to destroy it. By 2186, he had assumed the name Michael Kenmore, undergone more cosmetic changes to ensure his anonymity, and moved to Vulcan with T'Pol, where they had two children, Tamir and Lorian, the latter named after their son from an alternative future. Fun fact, if you're a fan of the TV show Stargate Atlantis, then you might recognize the name Michael Kenmore. Actor Connor Trenier, who plays Charles Tucker, also portrayed Michael Kenmore, an alien wraith turned human in the series. The use of the name is a subtle little nod to a character that Trenier has played before. Tucker was known to still be alive as of 2238 when he visited the Starfleet War Memorial for silent reflection, which was made impossible by a young James T. Kirk and brother Sam. Apparently, Trip unofficially had a hand in the construction of the Constitution-class starship by leaving notes in the margins for the ship's plans during the design phase. So let's talk about some theories now. So first, let's circle back to the theory on why his death was changed from 2155 to 2161. It was very likely to cover the fact that he had been up to some questionable missions during his time with Section 31, which, although they were in order to aid the Coalition and later the Federation, wouldn't have been becoming or acceptable for a Starfleet officer. Perhaps in a way of thanking him for his services, his history was changed and given a more valiant death, as played out on the holodeck scenario ran by Commander Riker. After all, we know Starfleet itself isn't beyond covering up involvement with Section 31 for the greater good. Take a look at Discovery. Which brings us to the next theory. We know the former Terran Emperor and Section 31 agent Philippa Georgiou was transported by the Guardian of Forever back to a time when she was not being pulled apart by the separation of the Prime Mirror Universes. This was done in order to get her in position for the upcoming Section 31 series. The Romulan War novels, and indeed others, went to great efforts to keep the character of Trip and his crewmates alive in various ways, and under different guises and such. How would that be for a start to the series? Telling the long-awaited canonical version of the Romulan-Earth War, skipped over and avoided by the quote-unquote bitter finale of Enterprise, perhaps not from a Starfleet point of view, but Section 31 and with Trip Tucker sprinkles. Did I just say sprinkles? Anyway, Enterprise can still have mentions, appearances, etc., but not draw away from the main focus of the show. There's also the Captain Pike-led Strange New Worlds also underway, which leaves an opening for the prequel series Enterprise characters to potentially appear. After all, they all live a lot longer in the future now, don't they? Think about it. Spock is dealing with some logical issue during a personal trip. You see what I did there? On Vulcan. He visits T'Pol, who should be at home with her partner-slash-husband Trip Tucker, or Michael Kenmore, if the book has any say in his name. At least this way, it has been 20 years, they're all older, and there will be no need for the aging prosthetics we saw for the likes of Dr. McCoy in The Next Generation. My good God, sweet Jesus, those prosthetics. Ugh. Anyway, let us know your thoughts on the Star Trek story for today. The return of Trip Tucker would certainly be an interesting story point for the arc of the character, and I think that Connor Trinneer would definitely be up for returning as Trip as well. We'll have to wait and see. In the meantime, I am going to sit here in the probably vain hope that something Romulan will one day be released that does not require me to learn 76 additional languages and grow 3 extra tongues. For the rest of you, if you want to stay up to date on all the latest Star Trek news, lore, and more, then make sure you hit that subscribe button to never miss a video from the team here at Trek Central. You can also follow us on social media or join our community Discord server. For now, I've been Ensign Adam. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time. And now, I have a strange craving for fried chicken. Live long and prosper, my friends.